Good afternoon. This is the professor, Dr. Ron Daniels, president of the Institute of the Black World, 21st Century, and distinguished lecturer emeritus at York College, or from York College, City University of New York, welcoming you to this March 11th pre-spring edition of Vantage Point here on 99.5 FM on the Pacifica Network in collaboration with ycradio.org. That is right, the York College radio community is plugged in by way of ycradio.org. Well, today we hope we have a very informative show. We are going to be joined shortly by Ebonie Jackson, who is the manager of the Women's Center at York College, City University of New York, talking about a very exciting program coming up this coming Friday. Tarana Burke, the founder of hashtag MeToo, that movement, will be with us at York College on this coming Friday, and we want to share that information with you, but also talk about the Women's Center, the work that they do, and some background on Ebonie Jackson herself. Also, we're excited to also hear from Roland Martin. That's right, Roland Martin of CNN fame and all kinds of stuff is going to be joining us this afternoon. Later on, after this interview, we'll be talking to none other than Roland Martin. So we're going to get right to it. Ebonie Jackson is on the line, I think. Ebonie, are you there?
I am. Thank you so much for having me, Dr. Daniel.
Of course. Well, first of all, guys, I'm going to come back to it, but I want to talk about you a bit and what's happening with the Women's Center and all that good stuff. But first of all, just give us the specifics on this great event that's coming up on this coming Friday at York College.
Of course. We are so excited to be hosting Tarana Burke, the founder of hashtag MeToo. It's going to be this Friday, March 15th, at the Milton G. Bassin Performing Arts Center at York College. We're located at 94-20 Guyar Brewer Boulevard in South Jamaica, Queens. The event will be starting at 5:30 and will feature a moderated discussion with Ms. Burke and some Q&A. We'll have some time for some Q&A from the audience as well. So we're super excited about that. The way that these events typically go, we also, in addition to our speaker, we also feature a book. The book this time around is called Hey Shorty, A Guide to Combating Sexual Harassment and Violence in Schools and in the Streets. And it is was written by two ladies from the Center for Girls for Gender Equity, which is an organization that Ms. Burke is associated with. So we're super excited for the book. We're super excited for the talk. And we can't wait.
I can't either. And we're going to talk about it a little bit more during the course of our interview, at the end we'll tell people how to get to the Performing Arts Center. Really very easy to get to York College, because the subway lines and public transportation is there,
yes,
as well as parking, all that good stuff. But let's talk about you a bit, Miss Ebonie Jackson. I have had the privilege and pleasure of working with you before my retirement. We worked on different projects together. But I never asked you, are you an original New Yorker or did you come from other parts? Give us a little bit of your background.
Sure. I am I'm a Queens native, born and bred.
Okay.
I'm from originally from Corona, Queens. And I'm a product of New York City public schools. And I went to Catholic high school at St. Francis Prep, right up on Francis Lewis Boulevard. So I spent a lot of my formative years here in Queens and running around the area around York College, doing stuff I wasn't supposed to be doing. But I went to the University of Virginia, where I met my husband there. And then when I moved back to New York, we moved to Brooklyn. So I live in Brooklyn now with my family. But for me, it was always very important for me to give back in my professional life to the area that raised me. And so I was very excited to come and work at York College.
And, actually, I didn't know you were from Corona because, I'm from East Elmhurst down this way, I know a little bit about it. I'm a relatively new New Yorker, but this is a rich history here in Corona and East Elmhurst and Jackson Heights. It's a rich history in this area, and I'm sure that contributed to your sort of commitment to be about this work. Talk to us about the Women's Center. What does it do? What is its mission? Talk to us about that.
Absolutely. So the Women's Center at York College has been around for almost the past 30 years. I joined the Women's Center in, 2012. And basically, at the Women's Center, we do lots of programs, but we do three things. The first thing that we do is providing leadership and mentoring opportunities for women. We assist students in building their leadership skills and accessing mentoring and networking opportunities like leadership conferences, receptions, workshops, everything that you kind of need to be successful once you graduate from your college with a degree. The second thing that we do is promote healthy lifestyles. And that's kind of a catch-all thing, healthy lifestyles in terms of mind, body, spirit, relationships, general wellness, women's reproductive health, all of that. So we have a bunch of events that we do around that. And the last thing that we do is domestic and intimate partner violence education and awareness. And we do that in quite a few ways, events like the one that we're having this Friday. It's definitely part of that series. And then we also try to bring trained students to become domestic violence advocates along with us to help me do that type of work in our community. So those are the three focuses of the Women's Center.
And how is the work being received? I mean, there was the fact that there's a Women's Center in and of itself speaks of a level of progress over the last half century. And certainly there's been so much, the last two or three years has just been, women's issues have just been front and center in so many ways. The major women's march that helped to really galvanize women all across the country, certainly all of the Me Too stuff that has broken into the forefront. So how is the center received? Give us a sense of your assessment of how it's going.
Well, I mean, as I mentioned, our Women's Center has been around for quite some time, and you're correct. I think that women's issues have certainly been at the forefront in the last several cycles, probably, in no small part due to our president in chief. but the Women's Center is well received. I mean, we have, at York College, it's 65% women. Female students here. And across CUNY, of the 24 CUNY campuses, I will say that only 9 campuses have women's centers. So I'm happy that York College is one of them, and that they value the work that we do. As usual, I would love to be better funded and staffed as I do this work. But we're a small but mighty group, and I believe that we're having a positive impact here.
Great. Now, as you reflect back over all the many programs that you've done, give us a couple of highlights, a couple of the programs that you really, really felt were extraordinarily effective. Because, when you do this kind of work, you have ups and downs, and you do a lot of hard work, and things don't always turn out the way you want them to, and so forth. But then there's these programs that you just said, yes, that's a wonderful program.
Yes. and we've had a lot of those. And I have to say that, programs like the one that we're doing this Friday, and we do a colloquium, which is our largest kind of program each year, are great. We've brought the public, she's no longer public advocate, Letitia James. She's now our state attorney general.
Oh, yes.
She was here a couple years ago. That was a wonderful conversation. We talk about feminists and grassroots organizing. So our big events are great, and you and I have done some large town halls here together. I have to say that I think most of the real change, and when I feel like I'm reaching students, are at our smaller events. We host a monthly roundtable discussion. We have a women's empowerment film series and a book club. And those are events that, you know, they don't have 100 people. They may have, you know, 15 people sitting around a table, but that's where we can really do a lot of work around exchanging ideas, discussing points of view, really understanding, you know, what it means to be a feminist, what it means, you know, for my brave male souls who come out, what it means to be an ally. And I think it's really those smaller group discussions that have the largest impact.
And before we get to concluding talking about the event for this Friday, great events. But in this work, I'm sure as you touch lives, I certainly feel that as an instructor, there are just times when there are persons that you look at and you say, wow, look at that success, or look at how this person has developed as a result of the work. Do you have some examples like that?
I have quite a few. I mean, it's you know, obviously the nature of any college is that, you know, students come in and then they get their degrees and they go out. And I think that one of the things I'm most proud of is really trying to maintain that connection with a lot of our alumni who've come through the school, who've come through the center, and are now out doing wonderful things. I bring a lot of our female students back for a mentoring and networking series every spring. And it's wonderful to see the things that folks are doing. Right. Social work, teachers, people who are traveling internationally. And it's really, really wonderful. I love to have my students. I'm sorry to see them go, but I'm happy that they're out there doing great work in our community for, you know, people who need advocacy and people who look like us. So I'm very excited every time I have to put that event together.
Okay, and then finally, let's go back to the event for this coming Friday. This is probably a pretty obvious question, but why did you select this topic, and why did you select Tarana Burke to come to your college?
Well, I have to say that I actually saw Tarana Burke speak at an event last year that was put on by the New York City Alliance Against Sexual Assault. And after seeing her there, I said, oh my God, I have to bring her to York College. I could think of no one more important and appropriate for our students and our community to hear from. It's not often that you have a movement that's started by and for women of color, and then they can come and speak to, you know, what we've got here, large swaths of women of color. So I was super, ever since last year, my goal was to have her here at York College. And then, you know, as you said, the issue of Me Too is just so relevant, prevalent. Sexual assault, sexual harassment, unfortunately, is something that we really need a lot more discussion on in our community. I had some women here in the center just last week discussing all of the R. Kelly brouhaha and talk about things that are just so relevant right now. And I hope to get give our students more perspective on that. In terms of what it means to advocate for themselves and to be an advocate for others, and how to use, you know, social media to do it. I think our students, you know, everyone's on their phones all the time. And if you can do something like what Tarana Burke did, is start a hashtag and really create and affect change in the community, I think that's definitely something I want our students to hear.
And I can tell you, and in the interest of disclosure to our audience, Tarana Burke is somebody I have known for many, many, many years. I first met her because, and of course, our students, and I don't know whether they met her because she eventually moved from Selma to Philadelphia and whatever, so I don't remember the sequence of events, but I go to Selma, or went to Selma. I haven't gone in the last couple of years. I decided to take a little respite after we took about 40 students to the 50th anniversary of the commemoration of Bloody Sunday. But that's where I first met Tarana. She was one of the key coordinators working with Rose Sanders and the 21st Century Youth Movement and whatever. And she's just very powerful and strong. And then she went out and spread her wings and created this organization in Philadelphia. And, you know, the issue of sexual assault has always been close to her. And by the way, she has been targeted, she's been cursed and threatened and so forth, because she has been on R. Kelly's trail for years. I mean, this is one of the issues that she has just pushed because of the willingness of people to give people who are perceived as heroes or celebrities a pass, even though their activities are just antithetical and harmful and hurtful to people, and these painful discussions internal to our community. So she's been on it, but because she's been on it, you know, she's had to undergo a lot of vitriol and a lot of hatred.
I'm sure
from people who are fans of R. Kelly and not even that. Why are you tearing down a black man? All those kind of things. But she has stood in there. She is strong, and I am so proud that she's coming to your college. And like you said, it's not often that you see, you know, a movement started by this black woman, you know, who had an idea, who put it out there, and now you see her on, you know, just everywhere. She is out there.
Yes.
And one of the things that's important is that we remind people where the origin of the movement was emanated, because sometimes it just gets co-opted and it goes off somewhere else, and people say, they don't really know. So this is important, and we certainly appreciate the fact that you have had the vision and the tenacity to stand there and to bring Tarana Burke to the conference, to the campus on this coming Friday. So just give us the information once again about when the event's going to be, where it's going to be, and how do people get there?
Absolutely. So we will be here on Friday, March 15th, this Friday. The event, it starts at 5:30 p.m., and it will be located in the Milton G. Basson Performing Arts Center at York College. Your college is located at 9420 Guyer Brewer Boulevard in South Jamaica, Queens. And as you said, seems like every train and bus in Queens comes over here. So there's way too many ways to get here. But anyone who can get over to the Partisan Archer train stop on the J and the E train, as well as many, many buses can come through. Yeah. The event is free and open to the public, and our Performing Arts Center is huge. We want as many people to be a part of this movement as possible. So please, we are inviting everyone to come out and enjoy the event this Friday.
Right. And again, Jamaica Center is the place on the different trains. I think it's the E and the
J.
E and the J, you know, go into Jamaica Center. And by the way, is there a phone number and or a website that people can go to?
Absolutely. You can find all of the information on the Women's Center page at the York College website. That's www.york.cuny.edu. They should feel free to call the Women's Center for any information. And our telephone number is area code 718-262-2008.
Okay, Ebonie Jackson, so happy that you're doing this, so proud of you, and particularly your commitment to return to the source, having been nourished
by this community and
your college. You come back, and that's a real sign of dedication and commitment.
Yes, and I would be remiss if I didn't thank you, Dr. Daniels, for your assistance in making this event a reality. I really appreciate all that you've done during your tenure here and even as you have retired from York College. So thank you.
All right. Thank you so much. Okay, we'll see you on Friday.
Yes. Thank you.
All right, Ebonie Jackson, and we'll continue to talk about this event again. Tarana Burke is a phenomenal woman, a phenomenal woman, and you really need to come out and see her. And I think it's important to come and salute her, because quite frankly, there's a way in which, you know, black women within the context of a broader feminist movement sometimes get lost. You know, it took me a minute to even realize that Tarana was even at the heart of this, because she wasn't really being focused on. She was really not being seen. She is now, but even now, you know, it's so we want to come out and celebrate her and to affirm her and let her know we love her, but also to engage in the conversation. You know, it's a much needed conversation. So again, it's 5:30. It is at the York College Performing Arts Center. I think it's 9420 Guy Brewer Boulevard. But you can call 718-262-2008, 718-262-2008. And that will get you, the information that you need. Or you can go to the York College website as well. I think she said www.york.cuny.edu will get you to the website as well. So we really want a large turnout. And there are books that are going to be available, as she mentioned, and Q&A and a good conversation and an opportunity to meet Tarana Burke up close and personal. Well, we're now awaiting Roland Martin, who is to call in actually to our show. So I'm sure we'll get that information as soon as it's available. Roland Martin, of course, needs no real introduction, but he's been dealing with a number of issues that I wanted to have him discuss with us, with our listening audience, if you will. So we're hopeful that he will be joining us shortly. But in the meantime, let me take this pause to also encourage people to become a WBAI buddy. We're always in fundraising mode because we need to be in fundraising mode. But particularly, I am a champion of and an advocate for people becoming WBAI buddies. Because what a WBAI buddy is a sustaining contributor to WBAI. That means for contribution of $10 or more, that's $120 a year, you can be a person who is on the rolls as a WBAI buddy, because your contribution will be coming in on a monthly basis, and that's so incredibly important. So in order to do that, and what that means is the management now is able to know what's coming in on a steady basis. I'm a WBAI buddy. Again, I don't ask for people to do that which I'm unwilling to do. And so I'm a WBAI buddy. And the way you do it is you can do it by credit card, or you can actually do it or by your checking account, or I suppose you could even do it from your savings account, my debit card. There's all kinds of ways to do it. You connect by givetowbai.org, givetowbai.org, and they'll set it up for you, or you'll be able to set it up online. And alternatively, if you have difficulties, you can also give us a call. But the important thing is, don't forget, this is community listener-sponsored radio, community listener-sponsored radio. And so it is terribly important that you understand that you are the donors. You are the funders that we've been looking for, that drive this process, so that the resistance in this critical era and the transformation that we see is in your hands. And, so become a WBAI buddy. We need hundreds of people to do that. And if that were to become the case, it means that we'd have a solid floor beneath this vital strategic institution moving forward. Well, we're still waiting for Roland Martin to connect, and hopefully he will be doing so shortly. In the interim, I'm going to do another quick announcement, then I'll probably take a quick break, because if all else fails, of course, the last part of the program is dedicated to your calls anyway, and I have a couple of topics that I want to tee up on from the soapbox. But I just want to start the conversation in letting you know that on April 5th in Newark, New Jersey, there will be a national town hall meeting, as a part of the National Emergency Summit on Gentrification, a summit about the issue of the displacement of black people and black culture. And it's going to be, again, 7 o'clock, 7 to 9:30 at the New Jersey Institute of Technology, New Jersey Institute of Technology. I'm hoping to get the station to partner on this a few weeks coming up, but we'll have, you know, information that'll be circulating. But just mark that on your calendar, the evening of April 5th, and Danny Glover will be there. You've heard Mark Thompson here from SiriusXM Progress 27, my dear beloved friend. There will be activists and organizers from all over the country meeting and strategizing about how to beat back this monster called gentrification that is just devastating marginalized communities, and particularly black and brown communities all across this country, including right here in various communities, you know, in New York. I mean, Harlem is not going to be recognizable as it once was in a few years. There's sections of Brooklyn that are vanishing, the Bronx. I mean, it's just incredible what's happening. So stay tuned, you know, for the national town hall meeting as a part of the National Summit on Gentrification. It will be on the evening of April 5th in Newark, New Jersey, at the New Jersey Institute of Technology. We'll be able to give you the specifics on that. We're going to take a quick break here, two or three minute break, and see if we connect with Roland Martin. But if not, we'll come back and take your phone calls here on WBAI 99.5 FM. You're listening to Vantage Point in collaboration with YCRadio.org. We'll take a break and we'll be right back. Okay, well, what we're going to do is go to our phones. In the absence of Roland Martin, that's one of the great things about our talkback format. Actually, there are times when I like to take the soapbox. We don't really have to have a guest at all, but we were really excited about having Roland Martin join us. He has a new show that he's doing called Roland Martin Unfiltered, which is an evening show. I think it starts at 6 o'clock or so every evening. And I had the privilege of being on with him last week to talk about the issue of reparations. And we agreed that he would come on the show today. I actually did the interview by Skype. And it was interesting because one of the issues that he was discussing was the judiciary and Supreme Court justices. And it's an issue that I've talked about on this on Vantage Point as well. And by the way, the issues that I want to tee up for you to call in on are a couple. One is this issue that's broken into news around anti-Semitism. And I'd like to get your views on this. And the question I'd like to pose, because President Trump has come out just yesterday, I think, and he's accusing the Democratic Party of being anti-Jewish because of the remarks which were not directly condemned by Representative Omar from Minnesota. There was a broad resolution, you know, condemning anti-Semitism and racism and Islamophobia and whatever, which some people felt was dodged the issue of what she said and the sense that it was anti-Semitic and that this was kind of a cop-out. But Trump has seized on this, and I think we can be prepared for more of this, because he's now saying the Democratic Party is anti-Jewish and by implication is anti-Semitic as well. So I'm interested in your views on that. 212-209-2877. 212-209-2877 will get you into the conversation. But the conversation that I was intrigued about with Roland Martin was he talked about the judiciary. And I was going to ask him about this because he used the example, read a tweet directly from the Senate whip from Illinois, whose name I'm blanking on at the minute. but is on the Senate Judiciary Committee. And it was the nomination of a 36-year-old attorney who had only tried, I think, about six cases, was not even recommended by the bar. I mean, it was just amazing. Totally unqualified, except for being a right-wing conservative at 36 years old. And they sort of calculated out the average tenure of a Supreme Court judge or justice. And she was not being nominated for the Supreme Court. I think it was for a district court. But the idea is or maybe it might have been an appellate court, which is even, both are bad. But like 30 years, like if she, in 30 years, she'd only be 66 years old. We have people RGB is still hanging in there. I think she's about almost 90. But certainly these judges tend to be in their 70s into their 80s. That's all these years, all those elections will have transpired. And the notion is the country is becoming increasingly, it's the browning of America, the whole immigrants and people of color that are coming in from everywhere. And the population in about 20 years or so is going to be predominantly people of color. And yet what Bush was a part of it too, but Trump has put it on steroids, is to in fact put in these judicial appointments in a way that means that it'll be a predominantly person of color country, but you'll have these right-wing conservatives who are in charge. I understand that Roland Martin is now on, so he's telling the story I wanted to have him talk to you about. Roland Martin, welcome to Vantage Point. Roland, are you there?
Yep, I'm here.
Oh, okay, yeah. I was sharing with my listening audience that one of the reasons I wanted you to come on, and you can tell it more better than I can, because I was talking about the fact that while I was, in by Skype and waiting for my interview on reparations, I watched your exchange and discussion around the judiciary and what was going on around that. But before I do that, let me just welcome to the show and to have you say a bit about what you're doing these days. Hashtag Roland Martin Unfiltered. What is that, and how do people connect with it?
Yeah, so when TV1 canceled News One Now, I immediately began to focus on, all right, what is it that I want to do? And recognizing the whole digital space, I focused at that point on, I said, okay, you know what, we're going to launch a daily digital show. Taking advantage of digital platforms, because there were limitations when we had News One Now. We couldn't put our video online. We knew that's where a younger audience was, a more diverse audience as well. And so we launched it in September. We started doing stuff in January, really doing live streaming events and conferences and things along those lines. And then, of course, we led up to it by launching The Daily Show in September. So we continue to do The Daily Show. We still do the live conferences. This Friday, I'm going to be in L.A. for XQ America education event. We're going to also be live streaming Melanie Campbell's Black Women's Roundtable conference as well. And so it's really about covering those issues and stories that, frankly, don't get covered, don't get lots of focus. I was down in Selma for the Bloody Sunday commemoration, and so we live streamed various events there as well. And that's really, the focus. How do we use new technology to be able to tell our stories, to control our narrative? And for me, it's also a matter of being able to own the show, controlling the show, and being able to sort of advance and own our agenda. I think, unfortunately, people don't understand. You have 8 black cable networks and broadcast networks that target African Americans. And so you've got Bounce, which is a broadcast network. You've got, which is not black-owned. Scripps owned it. You've got BET Own. You've got Aspire. You've got BET Her. TV1. TV1 just launched another network called Cleo TV. And those networks do, and also you have Revolt, owned by Diddy. So those networks do 1,344 hours of content a week. And you don't have 1 hour that is dedicated to a news and information show. Now, Breakfast Club does some new stuff. Of course, they put that on Revolt. You would look at BET as a 6-part docuseries special this week. But I'm talking about every single day, or even once a week, as a dedicated news and information show. Not 1 hour.
Mm.
What does that tell you in terms of where we're getting our information from? And then what that means is we're also being fed tons of entertainment, music, reality shows, old sitcoms. So how does it actually inform our minds? And so that's why I created Roland Martin Unfiltered, to build this thing from a show and then build it into a network.
Mm. Well, I think you're right. I mean, this is, you know, it seems that, you know, our black outlets, and we know these folks, and we love them and respect them to some degree, but it looks like they're a part of the dumbing down. In general, there's the dumbing down of America, and we sure don't need the dumbing down of black America, given all the issues that we face. So this looks like
If one of the networks say we're going to have a 1 hour weekly news show, at least that. You don't even have that. I mean, not even 1 hour.
Yeah, that's
a dedicated news show.
Right.
So Black Americans said 1,344 hours a week, and not one on the 8 black networks that is a dedicated news show. And so, you know, that was important to me. Man, I could have easily gone somewhere else and got a job, could have worked at some other network, but I said no. I mean, there were too many stories, too many perspectives that I found to be important that I wanted to be able to highlight and focus on, and so that's why I launched it. So it's no different. What I'm doing is no different than Robert Abbott launching the Chicago Defender, Frederick Douglass launching the North Star, having these, you know, AI Scott with the Atlanta Daily World, having these mediums where we can cover our stuff. You know, I keep telling black people, you know, we will rule the day when we're not covering our news. Look, I get entertainment and movies and music and hip-hop, all this sort of stuff like that. But what's going to happen when one day we look up and we are not controlling our news? That, to me, is scary.
It absolutely is scary. So, Roland, tell us how people access. It's every day, and it's from 1 hour to 1 hour.
Yep, we live stream the show every day on Facebook, YouTube, and Periscope. And then we restream the show 9 times in a 24-hour period. So you can access the show right now. You can go to our old shows, interviews, I mean, one-on-one interviews at youtube.com/RolandSMartin. We also want black folks to also know and understand that we also have to support it financially. We have to be the ones who are also making this thing happen. And so we ask people to, you know, join our Bring the Funk fan club, because that's what allows us to be able to go to these places. You know, I don't have any corporation that's funding my stuff. I don't have anybody who's cutting checks. You know, I am. But it's important that we are in that position to do this, and it's necessary. So they can go to RolandMartinUnfiltered.com for more information as well. But, you know, so it's just like people do subscriptions. You know, it's about us controlling it, man. And so it's just, you know, we're in a position to go places and do things other folks are not, and we got to be able to have that freedom and flexibility.
Well, I really appreciate this and think it's strategic and important, and certainly, you know, we hope our listening audience will join in it as well. Certainly we here in WBAI is a part of a broader strategic network as well in terms of trying to push progressive ideas and transformative ideas and whatnot. So hopefully this space will explode in a positive sense, will grow, because we urgently, at this moment in history, urgently need news and information and analysis from a black perspective. And that brings me to a couple of issues I wanted to talk to you too, because you know, those of us who do these talk shows and so forth, I mean, in the middle of the last election, it was tough, because trying to get people to see that elections matter was not the easiest thing, because, I mean, of course, people get angry with people, and I understood the anger of, you know, some of the stuff around Hillary Clinton, this candidate, that candidate, does it really matter, and so forth. But one of the things that I kept stressing was if you didn't care about nothing else, appreciate the importance of the federal judiciary and the Supreme Court. And so I was just struck by your conversation when you read the tweet and I'm blanking because from on the senator from Illinois. But would you just recap that, this 36-year-old person who's getting ready to come on to the federal bench?
Yeah. So the Republicans and conservatives have always understood the power of the federal courts, and especially after Brown versus Board of Education, after the civil rights advances. And so when you look at the Federalist Society, a lot of these right-wing think tanks, they were all born out of, after Barry Goldwater opposed the Civil Rights Act in 1964. And so, and then you throw in Roe v. Wade, you throw in other decisions, and then you throw in most contemporary decisions, same-sex marriage. I mean, conservatives despise what they call to be judicial activists, folks on the left from the courts. And so they have always made that a centerpiece. Well, progressives and folks on the left and Democrats have not. Now, they said, oh, the courts matter, but they have not said that this is a fundamental, central case to make. And so what Republicans have done, and you can go back to Ronald Reagan, their whole strategy since 1980 with Reagan, we're going to put as many conservative judges on the federal bench as possible. We're going to flood the zone. People who are far right, who are judicial activists, and what Democrats have always done is they've always fallen for the okey-doke with Republicans, and they've tried to choose moderates and stuff along those lines. And so that, to me, was the complaint that I had with Obama when he chose Merrick Garland. I was screaming on top of my lungs that Obama should have appointed a black woman. Now, people were saying, yeah, but the Republicans were never going to confirm her. Precisely. You knew that. So what they would have done is that would have served as a rallying cry to folks to say why you must vote for the person who was going to confirm her, or if Hillary Clinton had won, reappoint her. So what do the Republicans do? Donald Trump wins. They held up 100 appointments of Obama in his last 2 years. Trump comes in, boom, they fill him. They have been just dropping him. And what they do is they purposely appoint young federal judges. So here was a woman, 36 years old, North Carolina, only been out of law school 11 years. Had only been involved in 4 cases. They previously had nominated a 40-year-old guy who had never in his career filed a legal brief. During the hearing, there was one guy, they were asking him some legal questions, and he literally said, oh, we didn't cover that in law school.
Oh, Lord.
So the deal is, okay, so she's 36. She got confirmed, all right? We're going to be a nation that's majority people of color in 24 years. That means that this woman is going to be 60 years old, lifetime appointment. Well, guess what? That means that, let's say she retires at 80. That means that by 2043, majority of people of color, this woman will not retire until 2063.
Wow.
Meaning another generation will be born if she leaves the federal bench at 80. That is their strategy. It is to appoint young conservative justices that will be on the bench for lifetime, and that's what they care about. They are not, that's why, yeah, they were concerned about losing the House, but there was nothing more important to them than holding on to the United States Senate for the purpose of federal judges. And you had all these black people who, oh, there's no difference between Hillary and Donald Trump. Well, a lot. You could disagree with Hillary Clinton, and here's the other, with Hillary Clinton on 10 issues. But Donald Trump said that he had a sheet of paper that was handed to him by the Federalist Society, but they had already vetted these hardcore Supreme Court nominees. Donald Trump was not going to vary from that list, and that's what you see. That's why the white conservative evangelicals love Trump, because he is giving them conservative judges who they believe will rule against Roe v. Wade and rule against same-sex marriage, rule against civil rights, rule absolute rule against those things. And so black folks had better pay attention, because every time you file a federal lawsuit for age discrimination, race discrimination, sex discrimination, class action lawsuits, environmental racism lawsuits, education lawsuits, you are filing those in federal court. And if you don't pay attention, you may very well be and have a judge who is a right-wing federal judge who will be hostile to the very issues that you care about.
Well, I have called it, what I call it, it's in a different era, but I call it a Plessy versus Ferguson moment, because what the courts will do will provide judicial sanction for a right-wing reactionary agenda, and it affects everything, and it's so hard,
yes,
you know, for some people to grasp that. Well, Roland, we're about out of time, but I really appreciate you coming on and sharing with us, and again, letting us know about this new space that you're creating, which is an important space.
Sure.
We certainly, in Institute of the Black World 21st Century, have some things that are coming up that we're going to chat with you about, most notably this National Summit on Gentrification that we got coming up shortly. But beyond that, whether any of our stuff ever gets covered, the main thing is the issue of news and information and analysis. And we didn't get a chance to sort of talk about your background. I've known you from, you talked about these newspapers. You've always been a proponent and advocate of black newspapers, going all the way back to your work in Chicago and with blackamerica.com, all of that good stuff that you've done over the years. And it's so great to just see you have emerged as this great champion. So thank you so much for spending some time with us here today on Vantage Point.
I appreciate it. Call me anytime.
All right. Okay, Roland Martin, we did get him into the conversation a little bit late, but he's extraordinarily busy. He actually is, but again, Roland Martin at rolandmartin.com. You can go and check out his new show or get the information on Roland Martin Unfiltered, or you can just Google hashtag Roland Martin Unfiltered and you'll find his show. He'll be coming on the air shortly, and he does it on a daily basis, but then the ability to go out and do these live streaming, a whole new kind of methodology, not new, but taking advantage of it, is an incredibly important thing. I just want to reemphasize, we really didn't get a chance to get callers in now because it's almost time to go off the air, but I do want to say again, we really are hoping for a large turnout on this coming Friday, March 15th, at the York College, City University of New York Performing Arts Center. It is a beautiful facility. In fact, all of the senior colleges in the CUNY system have these beautiful performing arts center and centers, and York College has one of them as well. And 9420 Guy Brewer Boulevard, the event starts at 5:30, and we really want to pack the house. For Tarana Burke, this is the sister, this is the black woman who created hashtag Me Too. She's the one who started that movement. She's the woman who had the audacity to be a woman in the wilderness screaming out, we better watch and stop R. Kelly because he's doing damage to black women. He's assaulting black women, and that we need to. But, you know, she suffered a lot because of that. You know, the vitriol, tearing down a black man, so forth and so on. He's a celebrity. Why are we doing this? And so forth and so on. Well, the short answer to that is because people get harmed and hurt. It doesn't mean that people don't do other things that are good. I mean, look at Bill Cosby. You know, Bill Cosby did some good. But, Lord, have mercy. He really undid himself. And frankly, yet to apologize, yet to stand up and say, I had a problem, I had an issue. Yes, I did this. I'm sorry I hurt and harmed all these women. Where there's that much smoke, it ain't just a fire, it's a conflagration. And that's painful to see Bill Cosby in that situation. I know for many fans of R. Kelly, it's painful. But on the other hand, we have to deal with the pain inflicted on women, the assault that's been perpetrated. And Tarana Burke took heat because she was. But beyond that, she has just been wanting black people to have these conversations about domestic violence, these conversations about assault internal to our communities and how we handle, how we deal with it. And that's not to say that sometimes there are not some people who do false accusations and so forth and so on. We just saw an illustration of that, which was unfortunate in Chicago. you know, the staged assault that took place. But we know the data shows that very few women come forward. I think something like 52%, only 52%, because they're ashamed. They don't want to, they don't think they will believe. And of those, 97% are credible. 97%. It's been swept under the rug. We marginalized it. We made women feel that they can come forward. And Tarana Burke has been one of the people who've had the guts and the courage to be out there advocating around this issue. And therefore, hashtag Me Too has become a household word. It has become a symbol of the, this is the Me Too era. And it's because of this courageous black woman. She will be at your college, City University of New York, on this coming Friday, March 15th at 5:30 sharp at the Performing Arts Center. If you want further information, call 718-262-2008. 718-262-2008. Call and get the additional information. You can also go to the York College website and get the information, too. So if you just Google York College, the website will come up, and you can go and get the information on the Women's Center, and it'll have the program there. But I'll be there. I think I'm going to be introducing her, actually. She's a mentee sort of mine. I've known her for years and so proud of her. But that's beside the point. It's who, what she represents. And now she stands tall, not only in this country, but around the world as a global symbol of dealing with recapturing, or maybe for the first time, capturing our humanity and making sure that women are equal. And for that matter, even men who may be assaulted, because men get assaulted as well. Anyway, again, 718-262-2008, excuse me, 718-262-2008 to get that program. And also, don't forget, listening audience, you know, we love to do this, but we don't just do it to be doing it. I'm a radio activist, and I want to continue to be able to do Talk Back Vantage Point, and I want to do it with your support. So become a WBAI buddy. Become a WBAI buddy, as I described earlier. Just $10 a month will get you in. Go to give2wbai.org. Become a WBAI buddy. This is the Professor Dr. Ron Daniels signing off. We'll see you again here next week on Talk Back Vantage Point.
WBAI New York, 99.5 FM.